Welcome to our question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Could you please read Matthew 4, 1?
Okay, Matthew 4, verse 1. It says, "Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil."
And Hebrews 5, 7 and 9.
"Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he feared." And then verse 9, "And being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him."
Hebrews 4, verse 15.
Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15.
Yes.
"For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin."
And 1 Corinthians 10:13.
And that says, "There is no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it."
And the last verse is 2 Corinthians 12:9.
2 Corinthians 12:9. "And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me."
Are these scriptures referring to the elect following the Lord Jesus during the Day of Judgment, as well as the history of the Israelites also? But is it pertaining to us now?
As far as the temptation, well, yeah, I think there is of Christ's temptation, the 40 days he was tempted. Actually, it's interesting that Jesus, when he began his ministry, we know he was baptized by John in the River Jordan, and he came up out of the river, and the Spirit, like a dove, descended upon him. And the Father declared, "This my Son, in whom I am well pleased." So that's a picture of his death, going into the River Jordan to be baptized, and resurrection that took place at the foundation of the world, and the declaration at that point that Jesus is the Son of God through the resurrection of the dead, like Romans 1 verse 4 says. That was the end of chapter 3 of Matthew. And then immediately in chapter 4 verse 1, the Spirit leads Jesus into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And that begins his period of ministry on the earth. He was born 7 BC and he had been around 35 years or so. But officially, his ministry began in 29 AD with this 40-day period of temptation. And then we know from the Bible that his time of ministry was 3.5 years. And at the end of the 3.5 years, he went to the cross and demonstrated the death that he experienced at the foundation of the world. But following the crucifixion was the resurrection. And what happened? He showed himself alive with many infallible proofs for 40 days. And at the completion of the 40th day after the resurrection, he went up into heaven. And it presents a very interesting pattern. If you just look at Christ's period of ministry, 40 days, followed by 3.5 years, followed by 40 days. And there is the pattern. I don't think it's a coincidence, but we can see the pattern for the whole New Testament era. For example, the New Testament era, we could say, really started with the birth of Christ. The Old Testament was to bring forth the Messiah, and he came forth in 7 BC. And then from 7 BC until 33 AD, we have a period of 40 calendar years. So the New Testament era, we could say, starts with Jesus's life on earth, 40 calendar years, followed by the church age. And what figure does God use to represent the period of the church age? And we find that in Revelation 12, verse 6. We read of the woman who brought forth the man-child, and then she is led into the wilderness after the man-child is caught up into heaven. So you see Christ 40 years, immediately followed by the woman, according to Revelation 12, verse 5. At the end of the verse, her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. And Acts chapter 1 details that after 40 days of showing himself alive, Christ is caught up. Then verse 6, and the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days, 1,260 days. And if you would compute that or turn that into years using 30-day months, it would be 3.5 years. The period of 1,260 days would work out to 3.5 years of 30-day months. So we have in Revelation 12:5 the taking up of Christ and the completion of 40 years, followed by the woman led into the wilderness for 3.5 years. So again, we have Jesus tempted 40 days, Jesus' ministry 3.5 years. And then at the end of the woman's wilderness sojourn, and she typifies the church, the believers within the churches and congregations, comes the end of the church age, and the church age officially ended in the year 1994. And again, from 1994 until the year 2033, and we don't just pick that year out of a hat, but there's a great deal of biblical evidence that points to the year 2033 for the end of the world. So from the Jubilee year 1994, the year of the second outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the start of the latter rain and so forth, from that year 1994 to 2033, 40 inclusive years. And then would come the taking up of all God's elect into heaven. So we certainly see a pattern in just the ministry part of Christ's life with the 40 days of temptation, 3.5 years of ministry, 40 days of showing himself alive, and then going up. And we have 40 years of Christ's life, 3.5 years, which is spiritually representing the entire church age until its official end in 1994. And then 40 years to close everything out and finish with the resurrection of the elect. It's really an amazing parallel that we can see with these things. So as far as the elect, yes, even though Jesus' period of temptation was at the beginning of his ministry, we can still understand that these last 40 inclusive years from 94 through 2033 are a period of temptation or testing, severe testing as a matter of fact, and the testing ground is the Bible, and we've all experienced it. All we have to do is look back and we can see whenever God opens up new information, that is information that had been sealed until the time of the end, but since we're at the time of the end, it's coming forth. Whenever God has done this over the course of the Great Tribulation and now into Judgment Day itself, it is a testing ground for the people of God, for the true believers, and for God's elect as well. The question is that will we follow the truth, or will we follow the tradition? Will we follow the tradition of the church, or just the tradition of what we had been taught on a particular doctrine? And this has been the testing arena for the last few decades, and we can expect it to continue to be until we get to the very end of time. It is God testing those who would claim to be his people. And you see why it's such an excellent test is when the Lord opens up information, he's revealing doctrine and he's revealing his commandment. Whether that commandment be the church age is over and you have to leave the church, or hell will not be a place of eternal suffering with conscious existence forever and ever and ever, but hell identifies with the grave and it has to do with an eternal death, being destroyed or annihilated and ceasing to be. And I remember vividly when E-Bible Fellowship began to teach that, and we taught, it was at a fellowship group in Delco, and there was an individual in the audience, you know, just listening to the study. Nice guy. I mean, really nice guy. Always joking and friendly. He turned beet red. And I could see the anger coming into his face at what he was hearing. No hell. You see, people get very angry, or maybe not so much anymore, because people are accustomed to this, and those who have been listening to Bible, they understand the correction that has been made and the true biblical doctrine of the grave being hell. But early on, there was a lot of anger, and that's because people who had signed up or become Christian often did so in order to protect themselves from that place of eternal hell and suffering. It was like Mr. Camping used to say, the church used to use it like a cudgel and beat people with it in order to fill their congregations. And out of fear, people would come in and then the church would instruct them, do this, 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 do this, work, 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 and you'll escape hell. Of course, that's teaching that will lead people to damnation and destruction. But many people deep down had joined up, in a sense, to be a Christian, to sacrifice things of the world because they didn't want to end up in hell. And now it came forth from the scripture, there is no place of eternal damnation. It's just you die and it's over with, you're dead. And that is your judgment. And some people were furious at that. It's like, why didn't you tell me that at the beginning? And I never would have been a Christian. I would have just eat, drank, and be merry like everybody in the world. Well, you see, the people of God don't believe doctrine in order to get a benefit from it or hold to a doctrine in order to escape something. We believe it because God has given us a heart to believe and to trust Him and to hear His truth. You know, we come to God just because God is drawing us, frankly, and we have no other place to go once He begins that drawing process. But not so with the natural-minded individuals who never had a change of heart with God performing the heart operation of making them born again. And so there is a tendency to anger. And that was the testing ground, and this person or that person failed. Another doctrine, and same thing. You see, what may be the last straw, so to speak, for one person is not for another, even though they may both alike be natural-minded. But for this one, it's the doctrine of hell. For another, it's the shut door of heaven. And that gets them furious, and they'll go no further with these things. And they fail the test. The teaching of the Bible is designed by God at this time to be extremely trying for the listeners of the Word of God, because this is the final test. And so when Jesus said, if you love me, feed my sheep three times, why does he say that? Because the Bible defines love as keeping my commandments. And to keep God's commandments is to obey him and pass the test. The test, you have to have understanding of these things that have happened to properly feed the sheep. You have to know we've entered into judgment, there's no more salvation, and so forth. So there needs to be a humbling of the person before the Word of God, not before any man. But before the Word of God is revealing the revelation of God's righteous judgment, and then the Lord will bring His people through. And this is the reason that only those who are saved will endure to the end. They will endure the testing, the doctrinal testing that is practically constant throughout these 40 years, these 40 inclusive years.